Okay, so now we are going to continue in this lecture with the other basic instructions, basics of Internet of Things. So we have already seen that in the future it is estimated that the number of things are going to be many, the number of Internet of Things that are going to be connected are going to be many. So it is estimated as per one of the studies that by 2018 almost we are going to have 20 to 50 billion devices that are going to be internet worked. So many different applications, so many different devices, these devices are going to be made smart in these applications. So that is the reason why we are going to have an explosion in the number of these internet of things, number of devices connected to the Internet of Things. So as we can understand that if we want to internet work, if we want to form a network, a big network, a giant network of Internet of Things, that means these things being connected, then one fundamental problem that is going to happen is there is going to be an address crunch. That we are going to soon run out of the number of addresses that we can assign to each of these devices, the different addresses, for example, the IP address and so on. So IPv4 is definitely not good enough. People have explored the use of IPv6, but what is required is to come up with a completely new type of addressing scheme which can take care of these issues, the addressing issues because of this address crunch. The next thing is the connectivity. At present, there are different various sources, different various ways of offering connectivity. Cellular is one, Wi-Fi, Ethernet, then Bluetooth low energy, -7, Instion, 802.15.4, 802.15.1, 802.15.6, 802.16, so on and so forth. So many different connectivity mechanisms, connectivity standards are available. So this is going to be another challenge with respect to networking. So how you are going to have some kind of a handshaking between each of these different isolated standards? So this handshaking has to be, handshaking mechanism has to be devised. So in terms of connectivity, we are talking about concepts or unique building blocks such as the LAN, IoT LAN, IoT WAN, IoT node, IoT gateway, IoT proxy and so on and so forth. So almost analogous to what we have as the different components of the internet, the capital I internet, that means the internet of computers. Analogously, we are also going to have these different components, the LAN, the WAN, the node, the gateway and the proxy, these different components. So the concepts are very similar to as we have in the internet. So IoT LAN is very similar to the internet LAN. So this is for local short range communication, maybe building wide or campus wide and so on. IoT WAN is basically internet working of two different LANs, you know, interconnecting of two different LANs, connecting different various network segments organizationally or maybe geographically wide, and these can connect to the internet. IoT node, which is the connectivity of the different nodes inside a LAN, or maybe a WAN also directly. Sometimes the LAN, you know, the nodes in the WAN can also be connected. IoT gateway is basically sort of like a router or something very similar, which connects to the IoT LAN. So it is sort of like the outside world, the gateway beyond a LAN and typically connecting to the WAN. So we can have in a WAN, several LANs connected to each other through the individual gateways. And proxy, very similar to what we use, proxies for security, proxies for subnetworking and so on. So, if we look at the first picture over here, what we see is an is a IoT LAN. So, in a IoT LAN, we have these different IoT devices. Each of these devices has its own unique address, local address, and these addresses are local uniquely local. So, uniquely that means what I am trying to say over here is within a particular LAN, these addresses are unique, these local addresses are unique. And similarly, within another LAN, IoT LAN, these addresses are unique. So, these are locally unique addresses. So, it might so happen that a particular address might be unique to this LAN, but may be reused in another LAN. So, the other thing is that these two different LANs, they can connect via two different gateways. These are the gateway nodes. And also, we have seen that there is a concept of proxy. So, proxy basically connects, helps to connect to the external internet. So, proxy helps to connect to the internet. So, it is beyond the gateway and connecting to the internet that is offered by the proxy. So, some of the IoT network configurations are restricted to local areas, very analogous to what we have as internet LANs, WANs and proxy, and this is what we have seen in the previous figure. So, the nodes that are within the gateway's jurisdiction have addresses that are valid within the gateway's domain only. And the same address may be repeated in another domain, as I was telling you before in the previous slide, in the previous diagram. So, the gateway has a unique network prefix, which can be used to identify them globally. So, there is a unique network prefix as well, and we are going to look at it shortly. So, this strategy basically saves a lot of unnecessary address wastage, and although the nodes have to communicate to the internet via the gateway. So, for address conservation, as we have seen, these addresses are unique locally, but they can be reused in another domain. But these networks are connected to the internet, these IoT networks are connected to the internet through the gateway and these IoT routers. The network is connected to the internet, and these are connected through the routers, and these have their own set of addresses and ranges, that means the address ranges. So, these routers have multiple gateways that are connected to them, which can forward packets from the nodes to the internet only via these routers, and these routers assign the prefixes to the gateways that are under them. So, we have this prefix 1 and prefix 2, two different prefixes that are used, that are assigned by their corresponding routers to the gateway. So, prefix 1 is assigned by this router to this gateway, prefix 2 is assigned by this router to this particular gateway. Now, this is a very important concept that has been proposed, because it helps to solve the problem of mobility. So, basically what is going to happen is when a particular node changes its position from a particular network to another network. So, let us say from this network, this node moves and comes to this particular network. The prefix is also going to change from 1 to 2, and this is going to make the IoT LAN safe from changes due to mobility. So, IoT gateway basically, the IoT gateway WAN takes care of the address changes without change in the LAN address. So, within the LAN, the address remains the same, but with the help of assignment of this unique prefix, the WAN address changes, and that is how the mobility addressing aspect of mobility is taken care of. So, in this particular figure we see that there is this concept of the remote anchor point, and this particular entity in this network is the one which has the global view of the network that is underneath. That means, this entire network comprising of these LANs, this WAN, the gateway, the the routers and so on. So, this particular entity is considered to be the one which has the unique global view of this network underneath. So, now let us try to understand few other concepts surrounding it. So, we have already seen that there is a remote anchor point, and if there is a change in the network prefix, that can be taken care of automatically, and technologies or protocols such as mobile IPv6 can come helpful in these particular scenarios, assuming that IPv6 based addressing is being used. So, within a particular LAN, the address of the nodes remain unchanged, because they are within the gateway. And so, within the gateway there is a local unique address, and the change in the gateway's network prefix does not affect them. But it might be required for the nodes to communicate directly to the internet as well, and this can be done with the help of the concept of tunneling, where the nodes can communicate to a remote anchor point instead of channeling their packets through the router, and this can be done with the help of tunneling protocols such as IKEv2. So, this is how, with the help of IKEv2, this tunneling can be done with the help with the remote anchor point through the gateways. So, directly from the gateway to the anchor points, the tunnels can be set up like this. The gateway has associated, they can come with or without proxies, and they can offer internet connectivity or intra LAN connectivity. So, within the LAN they can offer connectivity between the different nodes within it. So, for upstream addressing, that means beyond the gateway, so gateway to the internet, mechanisms such as DHCP v6, assuming that IPv6 technology is being used, DHCP v6 for state based addressing, or SLAC for stateless addressing can be used, and the locally unique addresses are maintained independently of the globally routable addresses in cases where the internal address stability is of prime concern. So, we have to keep another thing in mind, that despite this mechanism of address stability, the ALUs cannot communicate directly with the internet or the upper layers, which is solved by implementing an application layer proxy. So, these proxies basically help in achieving connectivity to the upper layers on the internet. So, most of the IoT based solutions at present still are using IPv4. There are very few IPv6 implementations. So, what is going to happen is, if we want to deploy, if we want to approach building IoT by expanding the existing internet, the approach one that I talked about initially as part of lecture one for building IoT. So, in that particular case, what needs to happen is, there are different addressing schemes that are followed: IPv4, IPv6 and so on. So, something like address translation between IPv4 and IPv6 and vice versa has to happen. This is one, until we have a separate addressing scheme, a new type of addressing scheme. So, handshaking or translation of addresses from IPv4 to IPv6 or from IPv6 to IPv4, number one. Number two is tunneling of IPv6 over IPv4. So, maybe some part of the network uses IPv6. So, these IPv6 PDUs can be tunneled over IPv4 PDUs. Application layer proxies can also be used, and these can help in achieving tasks such as data relaying. Finally, I would like to mention that there is a concept of multihoming, where a particular node or an IoT device or the subnetwork, IoT subnetwork, can be connected to multiple networks for improving the reliability. So, basically multihoming is a concept that is used for improving the overall reliability of the network. In what way? So, in the sense that if some component of the network or maybe a node has gone down, there is another network that can take over. So, for this multihoming, there can be two different approaches. A proxy based approach can be used or a gateway based approach. I do not need to explain these two approaches in detail, but these names basically tell how the things are going to be managed for multihoming using these different approaches. So, providing source address, destination address and routing information to the multihome nodes is the real challenge in multihoming networks. So, presently IETF is trying to standardize this particular issue. So, IPv4 is being used, some parts IPv6 is being used, we can use both, but that is not going to be sufficient. We have to come up with a new addressing scheme, which we do not know yet what is going to happen. People are still working on it, researchers are coming up with different mechanisms. There are still lot of research efforts on building addressing schemes for IoT. But if IPv4 is used and IPv6 is used, these are the comparisons, points of comparison between the use of IPv4 and IPv6. The main point of difference is that because the bit length over here in IPv4 is 32 and in IPv6 is 128, the number of addresses in IPv4 is 2 to the power 32 only. On the other hand, the address space over here is 2 to the power 128. So, we are going to get a large address space, and I think we already know that there is a difference in the notation in IPv4, which is a dotted decimal notation, and it differs from the IPv6, which has a hexadecimal notation for addressing. So, here are few other points of comparison, which I am not going to go through, and here is the IPv4 header format, and here is the IPv6 header format. So, these IPv4 and IPv6, they have to work hand in hand until there is a new solution for addressing, a new mechanism, a mechanism which is completely different from these is proposed. So, they have to work hand in hand. So, you know, mechanisms such as tunneling or address translation mechanisms have to be used in order for this thing to happen. So, with this we come to an end of introduction on IoT, Internet of Things. We have already understood the motivation for building IoT systems, the different applications of IoT systems, the different characteristics of IoT systems, the different challenges that are involved from a networking perspective, what are the different components for building IoT. IoT is a giant network, but then you have to use a modular approach, a step by step approach, a phased approach to building IoT. So, what are the different components from a networking perspective that can be used is what we have already gone through and we have understood. So, with this we come to an end of the lecture on the introduction of Internet of Things. Thank you.